Hello, everyone, and welcome to In One's Kin. My name is James, as always, because I'm always James. And I'm joined by always Veet.
Buonasera.
Or should that be Don Vito?
Don Vito says buonasera.
I'm joined by always Robert, who's always Robert.
Lies, fabrications.
So, how has your week been, Robert?
A little bit of deja vu, but I've been discovering a lot of these conversational podcasts that are out there, and I didn't know that these were a thing. Like, I'd toss out names, but whatever. But just like a bunch of them that are out there, and I didn't know that this whole like alternative media was a thing because despite doing this podcast, being a major Uber geek and playing online video games and all that kind of stuff, I don't actually live on the internet. I'm kind of a news aggregate person. Like, I just consume knowledge of current events and history, and that's basically what I do all the time. So finding these podcasts has been a nice little change of pace for me, especially with the way things are right now. Like, things are just so crazy.
So you've been basically watching Joe Rogan's podcast, I see.
No, actually, not Joe Rogan's.
Interestingly enough, the people that you aren't naming have been on his podcast.
Yes, I know that everyone has been on the Joe Rogan Experience. I've caught this. I've learned this. One quite recently. But yeah, I was just I'm having a lot of fun with that, and I was kind of thinking to myself, that'd be kind of cool to do. And then I realized that no, it wouldn't be, because I would eventually start getting hate mail and death threats, and people would be like, "You're a dick," and just be like, "Oh, okay."
I make videos about World of Warcraft, and I still get told to kill myself.
Yeah, that's kind of what I mean. Like that's something I don't have to deal with.
Yeah.
Right now, I mean, I have plans in the works that I'm sure at some point I'm going to start getting letters from people, and they'll be like, "Oh, thank you. This is so great." And other letters are like, "I want you to get hit by a bus." And I'm like, "Oh, okay." It's inevitably coming. I mean, that's the other thing about my week is I've just been absorbing the news, and I'm coming to this realization, not that it's a new realization for me, but it's becoming more solidified. I guess I would say that we're so politicized in literally everything. We're so divided in so much of this stuff anymore that it's lost all reason. Like, actual conversation and debate is just completely out the window. It's like everyone is stricken up teams, and it's like sports now. Your team has to win. No matter what, your team has to win.
And
it's
only a racist drinks Pepsi.
Oh my God! Yes, exactly like that. That's exactly what it is. It's like right now the big joke is everyone's a Nazi.
Everyone is literally Hitler.
Everyone is a Nazi. Everyone's a Nazi. Okay, and one of the things that's cracking me up is I'm getting to the point where I'm old enough I actually remember these things. I'm like, yeah, every 4 years when we have a presidential election, everyone's a Nazi. All right, it doesn't mean anything anymore. This is insanity.
No, they've upgraded from being Nazis. They're literally Hitler.
I know. It's comical. It's comical, and it's devoid of merit and thought. I'm not going to get into it because again, this is not what the podcast is about. But I've just been.
Do we need to make another podcast?
We might. I don't know. I would go off the fucking rails.
Already don't have enough time. No.
But then I'd start getting all the hate mail. I'd start getting all that hate mail. No, I'm literally watching people make they're making I guess you could say really unthoughtful arguments. Like, they don't take the time to think about the fact that they have contradictory positions, and then they yell at the top of their lungs about how right they are. And it's just like, well, no, you're not. And I find it amazing that that's what's coming out of college right now, especially. It's people that are just vapid and brainless, and it's
so disturbing. College.
What?
Yeah.
So basically right. College.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. When I went to school, it was to learn something. That's always how I've been.
That wasn't my experience. My biology teacher was telling me that, like, microwaves are a government plan to sterilize men.
Well, yeah, there's that. No, well, you know, I think the weird irony of it all was when I actually did go into college, I got an art education degree. So, I mean, I'm an art teacher, K-12 certified, and I'm teaching Photoshop at community college, you know, so I'm all over the place. But when I was actually in the classroom, there was something really interesting that I did notice, which was all of my art classes were fascinating and full of, like, really thoughtful debate, political, cultural, societal. You know, there was a lot of really just really deep conversation in the art history class. And then you'd go to the educational part of it, and it was the most vapid, stupid crap I've ever come across in my life. I mean, just unbelievably politically charged, wrong, you know, ideological to the point of idiocy, and just shocking, frankly. Like, that was the educational side. There was no room for discussion. There was no room for creative thought. There was no room for disagreement. There was only the system. There was only the one standard. And if you ever deviated from that, you were a Nazi. And,
yeah. I mean,
and I was like, wow.
When my wife was getting her degree, she actually had a professor call and tell her she was stupid for what she thought. So wrong, she was stupid. He didn't want to educate her. He wanted to make fun of her.
Yeah, yeah. And I've seen that. I've seen things that are similar. And what's really funny is when you actually start seeing, like, okay, so what's your political bias? Oh, you're telling me this because you want me to vote a certain way. Oh, you're such a dick. You know, so I thought that was interesting. And that's kind of where I'm just kind of seeing right now. All this is, like, shaken up, you know, you got the fake news and everything else and all this stuff. And it's getting so bonkers that I'm just kind of like, I think I'm hiding in these conversational podcasts. Cause I'm just like, my brain needs to process something that makes sense instead of watching adults act like 5-year-olds on national television. No, my side's better than your side. No, my side's right. Screw your facts, man. Okay, that's great. Whatever.
We could yell louder. That makes us right.
American, yeah, exactly. Politics.
Yeah.
It's just getting worse.
You've been watching The Political Minute with Robert.
Like I said, I'm trying to keep myself chained down.
As I continue to insist that podcasts are a visual experience.
I know, what's wrong with you? Although you know, the other podcasts I have been listening to, they're all actually videotapes.
Yes.
They're videos, and they're all like, people want to watch their content now, dummy. I'm just like, oh god, I'm so old fashioned.
Yep.
So yeah. Anyways, that's basically what I've been up to.
All right, V, what have you been up to?
What have I been up to? I'm sitting here in a very hot room going, why is it so hot, as I'm sipping my hot coffee? Yeah, that's why it's so hot.
Logic.
That's a very hot coffee to increase the temperature of the room that much.
Well, when you're sort of hitting yourself up on the inside and outside, it sort of amplifies the situation. No, a bit of a quiet week because of today's topic. I was really keen to sit down and rewatch the Godfather movies, and there's 9 hours and 5 minutes worth of films to get through.
I made an attempt. I really did.
In just 3 movies, and I'll talk about the length here in a little bit. But oh my, I had a great time rewatching the movies and the sorest butt from doing so. I tell you what, not much else really. Oh, yes, I did finish watching the BBC Sherlock Holmes series, and I talked about it last episode. I just want to reiterate, I think it's some of the best television ever made.
Did you binge watch it?
Well, there's only 3 episodes. See? Oh. The BBC Sherlock Holmes series is 3 episodes for 4 years. They make 90 minute episodes. It's just a short season.
Somehow series. I miss that. I always forget that with the BBC, like a season can be 3 or 6 episodes.
Yeah, exactly. And that's what these are. 390 minutes television programs. There was a bit of talk about the last one possibly being the last and not all that great. Unfortunately, I have to agree with them. Everything up to that point was spot on until this very last episode. And I think while they haven't announced it being the last, I think it is the last because they tied off a lot of loose ends, which is a bit of a shame because this is not the way I wanted it to end. But if you've got the time, I can highly recommend this series. I can't look at Benedict Cumberbatch and not see Sherlock Holmes because of the way he portrays him. He does a fabulous job. Martin Freeman is a fabulous spoil. All the other characters fit in perfectly. It is just fabulous.
It's such a shame that they don't get along in real life.
I know. And I was flabbergasted when Claire told me last week. So maybe that's why they decided to pull the pin on it. I don't know. But I highly recommend it. That was my week.
I was just going to jump in there because, like you were saying, like some of the episodes are really short seasons and whatnot. And I actually think that's something that needs to happen more with American television because I don't like it when a show is just like, oh, we had a really good season. I guess we got to write up another one. And it's like, you didn't plan for this. You have no idea what you're going to do. And then it just becomes just progressively worse as the show goes on because they've blown all their good ideas. And now they're just writing for the sake of filling time. And I would much rather have something, you know, actually have a conclusion, like actually bridge it from a beginning, a middle, and an end. And this is still one of the reasons why I really respect Babylon 5, because even though it did have American seasonal television issues, it was plotted out from the get-go as 5 seasons with a beginning, a middle, and an end. So,
right.
You know, right. So, I want more things like that. You know, I don't care if they're like 3 years long, 4 years long, or even if they're only like half a season. I really like The Walking Dead right now, and I think it's because they only make as many episodes as they need to tell the story. Season one was only 6 episodes long. You know, now they're like 15 episodes long, but it's not like, oh, we got to have 26 episodes every year for reasons. You know,
I think that's what streaming television is helping create because a lot of that stuff, Netflix and Amazon, are producing 8, 10, 12 episode seasons. And I think because they're short, you know, less time to create, they are able to create a better story.
Yeah. Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
I agree.
Yeah, all right, your week's done. That was your week. That was his week. He agrees.
That was my week. Yeah.
No, that was James's week.
We done your week, James?
No, I'm kidding.
My week was, I agree.
Okay, sweet.
My week is working. That's basically all I do now. I don't do interesting things anymore. I just work.
How far away is work? Like, how far do you have to drive?
It's like 15, 20 minutes.
No, it's not too bad.
No, it's not too bad.
At least you haven't got a long day and an hour and a half on either end. You know, that would suck. Really suck. But yeah.
I guess there's that.
Yeah, there's always positives. Little positives everywhere.
I haven't been mauled by piranhas on the way to work.
There you go. See?
So what's the episode this week?
So as I've alluded to, this week is about the Godfather film series. Two of the three movies, there's only 3 in the whole series. Can't really call it a franchise because they decided to make the first 2 and then some 18 years later they decide to make a conclusion, I guess. First 2 movies are brilliant, and we'll get into that. The 3rd movie, I didn't remember a single squat about it, but we'll also get into that. Before we do, Robert, what's your recollection, or when did you last catch any of this content?
I saw it several years ago. I'm actually not a fan. Oddly enough. I know. Discontent. No, I'm not into it. I find them incredibly boring. So that's just kind of my problem with them. It's a stellar cast. The acting is pretty good. There's some really memorable lines and some good, decent scenes in there. But for the most part, to me, it's just kind of a snooze fest. And they're far too long for that kind of content. For the subject matter, I've never been like big on mobsters or mafia or any of that kind of stuff. You know, I'm not interested in like the Al Capone TV specials. It just doesn't float my boat. I'm not like a hater for the franchise. I totally get why people like it. It's just not my thing. I'm much more into fantastical things and more, I don't know, like just crazy nonsense. You know, and that's not to say I don't have a place for this kind of stuff, but it's like for some reason in particular, mobsters, I just don't care.
Right. Okay. What about you, James?
I think this is a series in which I know more of it than I know about it. Like, right. I know about all those, you know, the lines that people quote and Marlon Brando and Al Capone. I mean, Al Pacino. Al Capone. Sure. That's a different mobster. My brain. But I actually think I may have seen them a long time ago and just not remembered.
Yeah, no, fair enough. That's quite true. For me, these movies, I break them down into two parts and explains why these movies, particularly the first two, are so influential and have impacted my life so much. In that there's the film, there's the creation of the characters, there's the star power, there's the storyline, there's the intrigue, the sort of the wheeling, the dealing, the sabotage, all that sort of thing that goes into these movies. But there's also a very personal connection, and I'll make these personal connections as I go through, because it focuses on the Italian immigrants who emigrated to the United States, similarly to how my family immigrated to Australia, and I've Italian-Canadian family, and I know of Italian-Argentinian people, all these Italians, mostly Southern Italians who emigrated sort of anywhere from about 1890 all the way up to about 1960s to, you know, Australia, Canada, USA, Argentina, a little bit to New Zealand, et cetera. So, and there's a lot. Go on.
I was going to say, this better not be the episode where we find out that the reason your father emigrated was because of an attempt on your grandfather's life by the Sicilians.
Life. No, not quite. And there's no mob connection, no mafia connection in my family. There's none of that. It really comes down to that connection that a lot of Italian immigrants and progeny of connected with these movies, and they'll come a bit more evident. So let's talk about the first movie, The Godfather, 1972, runs for 2 hours and 45 minutes. This is the shortest of the three films. It's based on a novel by Mario Puzo, and you'll find, as I go on today, the Italian in me will come out, okay? So I don't know whether to apologize or not, but you'll notice it. It has that influence on me. Directed by Francis Ford Coppola. Up until this point, the only movie of note of his was Patton. He then proceeded, obviously, to go on and make Godfather Part 2, Godfather Part 3. He's well known for movies like Apocalypse Now, another one of my all-time favorites.
Also Marlon Brando.
Also Marlon Brando, yep. The Outsiders, The Cotton Club, Peggy Sue Got Married, quite an extensive filmography.
He also, one of the things I find interesting about him is he had a tendency, and I think it was just I'm in the right place at the right time. He had a tendency to completely paint people's perceptions of these people in real life and of these events. Like his take on the Vietnam War is highly sensationalized.
Yes.
And yet people are like, well, you know, it was like Apocalypse Now. No, it really wasn't. But that's all they, true. That's all they see it like was Apocalypse Now.
There was
now.
More heroin.
No. Yeah. But it's not, I'm just saying like his take on it was actually pretty far removed from the reality of it, but that's how people see it. Patton especially was interesting to me because Patton was a small guy with a tiny voice and he hated his voice. Patton in real life hated the fact that he did not come across like a badass when he's this high ranking general. He couldn't stand it. And then in the movie, it's, you know, you have the flag and the speech and it's just Patton is this, you know, just larger than life. I will kick you in the balls figure. And it's like people think that was Patton. Patton was so not that. So, yeah, he's definitely left his mark on the popular culture.
Oh, and same with these movies.
Yeah, and that's what I was going to say with these movies, especially because now a lot of people look at like Italian families and all this kind of stuff. And it's just like everything. Even I was just watching freaking Ninja Turtles, the new Nickelodeon one. And it's like there's a mob boss who's modeled after the characters in these movies. It's like, whatever.
Yeah, exactly. And we've mentioned the all-star cast. All three movies have an all-star cast. In this one, we've got Al Pacino, Marlon Brando, which is probably the only role of his that I enjoy from beginning to end. Robert Duvall, James Caan, Diane Keaton, Abe Vigoda, Al Martino. It is huge. And a lot of these guys at that time were just starting off in their careers too. So this was a major stepping stone for a lot of these actors. Just a little bit of a synopsis on the story. Begins with Don Vito Corleone declining an offer to join in the narcotics business with notorious drug lord Virgil Solozzo.
Hang on, back up there. You forgot to mention the 20 odd plus minutes of a wedding.
Hey, the wedding. I'll talk about the wedding. Don't you worry. I've got a personal connection with those weddings. So there's leads to an assassination attempt. Meanwhile, Vito's oldest son, Sonny, takes over the family and Michael strikes back for the assassination attempt by killing Solozzo and a corrupted police captain, forcing Michael to go to Sicily in hiding. Michael returns to America after news of his brother's Sonny's murder. After returning, Vito turns over the reins of the family to Michael. Michael plans to move the family business to Las Vegas. But before he moves, he plots the killing of the heads of the five families on the day of his nephew's baptism. And that is just like a tenth of the movie. There's so much there. Yes, some of it's filler. Some of it is creating the history, the backstory,
the characters are too interwoven for them to just start killing each other on face value.
Right.
Like it wouldn't make any sense.
No. And there's a lot of these movies use flashbacks to go back in time and tell points in time to sort of create that interconnection between all these families, all these people.
I was just given Girl Scout cookies.
Oh, nice. Which ones?
I just said Thin Mints. I got to open this.
I didn't hear. That must have cut out just then. Now, I've mentioned in previous podcasts, we never went to the movies as kids. And when I think back at this movie, there was actually nobody in my family or greater family, and I'm talking about my uncle and auntie, my grandparents, extended members of the family, actually went to the movies either. It was sort of seen, I guess, as frivolous, a bit of a waste of money. A lot of these people were, you know, working very hard physical work and were frugal in their savings. And going to the movies, I guess, was seen as frivolous. The only mention I think of my mother and my uncle, so my mother's brother, of ever going to the movies was part of a school day trip. My mother talks about being taken on a school trip to the movies to go see Sound of Music, and she always lights up whenever she tells that story. So, like I said, it came out in 1972. Nobody I knew had actually gone to see these movies. It was announced it was coming to Australian television, I want to say late 70s, and there's a lot of hype and a lot of build-up. Now, 2 hours 45, they have to break it up into two nights. So they build this thing up as a two-night extravaganza of The Godfather. And, you know, the word has spread around the Italian community that I'm a part of these movies, and it's set in Sicily and it's about the mafia. You'll see a lot of images and so forth that will connect you to where you came and, you know, and what the life you're living now. So I have a distinct memory, particularly with Godfather and Godfather Part 2, of when these eventually came round to being seen on television, of us being at our grandmother's house. We'd had dinner. It was building up to 7:30, because they probably started them at 7:30 because they were so long. And me sitting on the shag pile carpet of my grandmother's living room, all the older people on the sofas and so forth, as we came to watch this movie. It was the most violent movie that anybody, I believe, in my family had ever seen to that point. All the gun violence, people being shot up, the severed horse's head in bed. And I remember as the movie's going on, as the violence becomes quite evident, of exclamations coming from behind me of people being shocked and horrified of this portrayal of violence on television. The funny thing is, so there's all this violence and people are uncomfortable and sort of shocked. There's a scene in the first movie when I mentioned it, that Michael escapes to Sicily to hide. He meets a fair maiden, falls in love, gets married, and when it's evident that it's the wedding night, I get shooed out of the room. I get chased out of the room. I can't remember if I was sent on an errand to go get a basket of walnuts or what the hell ever, but they knew what was coming, and that was the revelation of Apollonia's boobs as she undressed. So the violence was fine, but the boobies were not.
Go figure.
You can see a man lay in bed covered in the blood of a dead horse, but if you see a breast, civilization crumbles.
You got it. Oh boy. Yep. And I just think back to that moment. I thought, just bloody brilliant. Just brilliant. Now, realistically, I would have been 8, 9, 10 years of age, somewhere around there. I was too young to truly understand the context and the content of the movie. But I remember the hype, I remember the anticipation, and I remember the connections my grandparents and families made with the movies. And by that I mean they picked up on the fact that they were speaking Sicilian, they were not speaking Italian. Now, Italy is made up of different regions, similar to how the United States is made up of states. Australia's made up of states. Mm-hmm. Italy's made up of regions. Each region has its own dialect, not accent, but dialect. And there's enough of a change in the language that makes it quite distinct, similar but distinct from people from different regions. And it's very obvious, I picked it up straight away watching these movies the second time round, that yes, they were speaking Sicilian. There's certain words, there's certain phrases that they use that no one else uses in Italy. They picked up on that. They picked up on the images of the Sicilian countryside. Now, my family come from a region called Calabria. If you look at Italy as the shape of a boot, Calabria is the foot region, not excluding the heel. So that's Calabria. Sicily is the island off the toe of Italy. They share very similar countrysides and landscapes. So they automatically, with the images of the Sicilian countryside, talked about how it reminded them of home. They talked about, the women being off doing their own thing and the men were off doing their thing as well. And then if the two groups accidentally crossed paths, they would make every effort to sort of like separate and go off again in separate paths. There's a scene where Michael eyes Apollonia for the first time, is smitten. They make their way to a tavern where they order drinks. Michael's bodyguard waxes, sort of exaggerates about this beauty they found, they just saw, and if they knew where she was from. And as he continues to describe this gorgeous babe, to use a vernacular, the tavern owner realizes that it's his daughter they're talking about. And instead of, and this is so typical of the family I grew up in, because I had a similar sort of experience, witnessed a similar sort of experience growing up. Instead of the father being annoyed with the man who's talking somewhat grotesquely about his daughter, he goes off the back to yell abuse at his daughter for being seen as curvaceous and attractive, more for just being seen and for being noticed. And that struck a chord when I saw it this time around. We talked about, James mentioned about the wedding at the beginning. I can't tell you how many weddings I've been to, particularly in my childhood, that sounded and felt like that one. Not as extravagant monetarily wise, but the sounds, the feels, the behavior of the people, the arm waving, the gesturing, the kissing cheek to cheek, it just flooded back memories of similar experiences growing up as a child. And again, how I watched these, particularly the first two movies, not so much the third, it hit every nostalgic bone in my body. It just my arms started waving and gesturing. I started making comments to the television in Italian, or Calabrese, I should actually say. I don't actually speak Italian. What I do speak is a dialect of Calabria. And how much I enjoyed these movies, how well acted they were. Yes, they are long. Yes, they go into extended bits of detail. Yes, today they would have been edited so much more than these movies ever were. Like I mentioned, it's my favorite role of Marlon Brando. And you see Al Pacino as an actor grow from this point on. As a movie also, I, for some reason, feel very connected to and I have very sympathetic feelings for Fredo. Fredo is the second oldest son, very kind-hearted, very generous guy, but he's best described as not the sharpest crayon in the pack. And he makes decisions that disgrace the family, put Michael's life at jeopardy at one point. Just not, like I said, the smartest person, but you can't fault his nature. You can't fault his good heart, big-heartedness. And I really connect with this character, and was just like, when we get to the second movie, you know, I just felt so much for this particular guy. So that, for me, is The Godfather. I think it's a very complete movie. On its own, it's certainly one of my best all-time movies. 2 years later comes Godfather Part Two. Now, so Godfather makes a comes out, is highly acclaimed, huge reviews, makes exceptional amount of money. It's probably from all the Italian American, Australian Americans going to see it once or twice at the movies. Who knows? They make Godfather Part Two. Again, I don't know of anybody who in my family went to see it. This, for us, was a television experience. It was made in 1974. This goes for 3 hours and 25 minutes. The Netflix version still has the intermission card halfway through the movie.
I find that amusing when you mention that.
I laughed. I just stood there and going, oh, they just left it in. They just left in the intermission card. I just thought, oh, okay. And I just paused it. I went off and went to the bathroom, had a drink, and I said, okay, I'm ready to continue now.
Funny enough, I still remember actual intermissions in movies. Mm-hmm. I remember going to go see Gettysburg, and there was an intermission. We went to go get more popcorn. Braveheart, there was an intermission, you know.
Yeah, Lord of the Rings.
Lord of the Rings did not have intermissions.
Did it? Huh?
No. Yeah. No. No intermissions. There were multiple movies.
I thought there were no intermissions.
There are intermissions on the extended cut of the DVDs, because they couldn't fit it all into a DVD disc. These are not present on the Blu-rays.
So, Mario Puzo, who's the original author, and since the success of the first novel and movie, has proceeded to make a number of Godfather books, never wrote a specific Godfather Part Two book, but was involved, in writing the screenplay. Now, in the first movie, we lose Marlon Brando, we lose James Caan, but this time we're adding Robert De Niro, Bruno Kirby, Harry Dean Stanton, and Danny Aiello. Cast continues to be brilliant. Now, this film is in part both a sequel and a prequel, presenting two parallel dramas. The main storyline, following the first film's events, centers on Michael Corleone, the new Don of the Corleone family, trying to hold his business ventures together from about 1958 to 1959. The other is a series of flashbacks following his father, Vito Corleone, from his childhood in Sicily in 1901 to his founding of the Corleone family in New York City. Now, you just know that today they would have just made this totally different than what they did back then. If they had made a movie that was The Godfather and it was as popular, they would have come out and made a sequel, a two-hour sequel, followed by the third movie being a two-hour prequel, or vice versa. They would have if, particularly if it came out as successful as it did, they would have tried to create the cash cow.
Sure, and I wouldn't argue that. What I was just going to say is it does still depend, though, on the structure of the plot. Like, if they had designed it in such a way that the prequel plot and the sequel plot actually intertwined at some point, like something that had occurred in the past, you know, directly right. Yeah. Leads into an event in the future. Think of it as like a 3-hour episode of Lost. You know, you could do things like that. I do get what you're saying, though, because, yeah, it's kind of weird because they basically go, well, let's make a sequel and I want to tell all these things.
Yes. And then that's
what they do.
Yeah. And it's right. And you're right. There is no direct connection between the Michael Corleone story, the current ongoing story, and the flashbacks. The flashbacks, and it's not just a 2-minute flashback here or a 5-minute flashback there. These are substantial. I want to say a good hour of the 3-hour movie is telling the prequel, is telling the Vito Corleone origin story, right? And that there, and it's done as a way to, I guess, in a way, to reconnect to all those Italian immigrants, all those migrants who watched the movie and connected with that aspect of the movie. I think that may have been part of it. It does build up. It does sort of create. It does sort of give you a bit of background story as to the personality that Michael grew from, his father, that who he admired and who he grew from and took advice from. So it helps create that. But there is no intertwining of stories. There is no characters that were in modern day shown in flashback that come back in modern day. There's none of that. They are very separate. So we told you about that. Yes, we mentioned that. I'm just going off my notes here, folks. There's a lot for me to try and remember. Again, very similar personal experience, the anticipation, the hype. Again, another 2 hours, maybe a two-night movie extravaganza, maybe even a 3-night extravaganza. I don't quite remember, but definitely 2. Again, the hype, again, the anticipation, again, me sitting cross-legged on my grandmother's carpet, surrounded by my family as we watch this. Now, there are no boobs in this, so I didn't get shoot out at any time. It's not actually as violent. There is violence there, but I think it's a little less violent than the first one was. And because of the, I'll call it the flashbacks, the prequel story, the Vito Corleone story, there's an even greater connection with the sort of immigrant Italian of living in the quite poor, quite remote Italian villages of southern Italy, of the sort of the desperation to emigrate away from this, and the process. So you see the process of Vito Corleone going through Ellis Island, which I've been to myself, and been through those rooms that were, they used a lot of that on site footage there at Ellis Island, and they recreated that. And I've walked through those buildings and those shower blocks and the dormitories, basically. And a lot So, yes, my family didn't go through Ellis Island, obviously, but they had similar stories, similar connections of what it was like deciding to uproot everything, having your life reduced down to two suitcases, walking into country with no papers, having your name, surname changed at the whim of the customs officer.
Yeah.
That sort of thing. And so as I'm sitting here watching this movie, I said, I'm quite young. I'm not making complete sense of it. I'm just too young, too immature. But all the whole time, there's this constant chatter behind me. Who remembers this? Who remembers that? Who makes comment of a particular Sicilian word that gets used in the movie? Who repeats certain Italian lines or Sicilian lines. So it was really in part difficult for me to understand, in part because nobody behind me would shut up. And I was certainly at 8, 9, 10 years of age wasn't going to turn around and tell anybody to shut up. I want to listen to the movie. But it was an experience. And again, rewatching this movie hit every nostalgic bone in my body. I don't think it's not as good as the first one. I think separately, if they were to separate them, I think they're fine. I think they were probably being innovative for the time in telling the story this way in a film, spending so much time in flashback and so much time in current day. Like I said, they would have handled this movie very differently today.
Well, none of that would be as long as they are if they were made today, that's for sure.
Oh, no. No. Oh, boy. Oh, no. Now, another piece of a thing that watching it this time around reminded me of a little personal story. When we grew up, my grandfather, my father, sometimes my uncle made their own home wine. They had a cellar out the back of the garage and they made their own home wine. We never bought bottled wine. We just never did. People would go around and giving flagons of wine as presents, as gifts to other families if they went visiting or stopped over for a chat or whatever, they would present a bottle of their own wine. So there's never a shortage of wine. But the thing I remember distinctly was we drank, if you look, watch Godfather 2, particularly in the flashback episodes, parts, they drinking wine out of tumblers, the exact same tumblers that we had in our house till I was probably 12 or 13 years of age. And we drank wine out of tumblers. And that's all I ever knew. I never knew bottled wine existed. And it wasn't until I got to university and I made my friends there at uni, and we would meet up for an evening, go to a movie, go to a restaurant for dinner, and in front of me, somebody would plop a bottle of mass-produced wine in a traditional, what we consider now traditional, bottle of wine with a cork on the top and wine glasses. I had never seen wine glasses until I was probably 18 or 19 years of age. Everything was drunk out of these tumblers. No matter whose house you went to, wine was drunk out of tumblers. And then all of a sudden I go to a restaurant and they're pouring wine into these long stemmed things that I had no idea, never experienced. And watching Godfather 2 reminded me of that whole experience. Now it's like, now I will actually, on occasion, if we get a bottle of wine to have for dinner, I will pull out tumblers and we'll drink out of tumblers just for nostalgic reasons. Still, this movie and the first one are still to this day the only original movie and movie sequel to win both Best Picture Oscars. The problem now is, and I don't, that will never be topped, because now they're, because they now know there's most likely to be a sequel to a good movie, that they save the Oscars for the last of that series. Point in case is the Lord of the Rings movies. It was very obvious that they were going to make three movies right from the beginning. It was announced early. They were great movies. Very little difference between one, two, and three movies, but they saved awarding all the Oscars for the third movie. So I think the likelihood of an original movie and a sequel ever winning a Best Picture Oscar is probably next to nil. But that I might be proven wrong.
Well, I don't have much respect for the Oscars anyway, so.
Sure. Yeah. No.
They're voting in their own self-interest. It's like trading favors. It's like, oh, it's your turn, right? It's like,
oh yeah,
so and so did an amazing job this year. Yeah, but they've won too much. It's like, I see how it works now.
Yeah. Or somebody's had a long illustrious career and has yet to win anything, and they've made a sort of average sort of movie, but they go ahead and win the Oscar for that.
Yeah,
that particular performance.
John Oliver did a segment on that and actually had one of the people who works for Netflix on the show go, hey, no one took us seriously because we didn't have an Oscar. So we took all these, you know, high up people out to dinner. Now we have three.
Yeah, exactly. So, no, I fully accept all that. In my house, it is a bit of an annual event, you know, to watch the Oscars and have a bit of a gamble. But, you know, we all know that it's just the
wrestling business of celebrity.
Yeah. Yes, there you go.
Celebrity you heights.
Yeah. So these movies, 1972, 74, well-regarded, very financially successful movies. And then that's it. Mario Puzo continues to write Godfather movies. There's speculation here and there about what about a third movie? Let's create a trilogy, that sort of thing. Well, it's not for another 16 years later they decide to make Godfather Part 3. It's 1990. It's a 2-hour and 50-minute movie. And even though Godfather 2 is a 3-hour, 25-minute movie, this movie feels the longest out of all of them. It is very slow, very tedious. Now, like I said, I've rewatched these three movies. I have strong recollection of the first two, both visually and basic storyline. I saw this movie, it was in 1991, I think, by the time it came out in Australia. When I sat down to watch this movie again, and I watched it earlier today, I do not remember a single Zach of the movie. Nothing.
A what?
Zach. Zach is like a coin. Not a single coin.
Dude, don't remember anything. Keep your foreignness away from us.
except for two things. I do remember Mary Corleone's death scene at the end. Mary Corleone is Michael's daughter. And I do remember Sofia Coppola, who's Francis Ford Coppola's daughter, who played Mary Corleone, getting given a very hard time for a very atrocious acting. That's it. That's all I remembered. I sat down to watch this movie and I go, no, don't remember this scene. I don't remember that. I don't even remember I don't remember the Vatican having anything to do with this story. I don't remember the opera in Sicily. I remember nothing. And I watched this as an adult, as a 21-year-old. Nothing. So Francis Ford Coppola and Mario Puzo co-wrote the screenplay. This time round, we lose, unfortunately, Robert Duvall. Not that he was killed in the previous movie. He was upset that he was getting way less money than Al Pacino. It was reported that Al Pacino was offered 5 times more than Robert Duvall was to appear in this movie.
I actually remember that. I remember that being in the news.
Yeah. Okay. And I was, having watched it then, I remember a lot of my feelings coming out from having seen the movie, even though I don't remember the movie. And I was disappointed that he wasn't there. Like, if he had been killed off in the second movie, fine. But he wasn't. He was just, they just showed his widow and young daughter, or younger son, I should say, to insinuate that he at some point has passed. And I like this character because there was the family, right? There was, you know, Vito Corleone, his wife, the multitude of sons and a daughter, and the extended family. And then there was Robert Duvall's character, who was basically adopted into the family and treated as one of their own and regarded as one of their own, of Irish heritage. And he was brought in, raised up by the family, sent to school to become a lawyer to their benefit.
Oh, he's the German-Irish guy.
Yes. Yes. Right? He's adopted and treated as a son. And they even give him lines in Italian to reel off to show that he's part of the family. He's grown up in that family. So I was disappointed that he wasn't there. Man, this time, sucks. It was. You know, they could have, I don't know, offered Al Pacino 4 times the amount and thrown Robert Duvall 1/10 of that or something. I don't know. Whatever. This time they've added in a very young Andy Garcia, a very young Bridget Fonda. I've mentioned Sofia Coppola, who I don't think she's not a great actress. It wasn't great, but I don't think it's as bad as the critics made it out to be. Thankfully, she turned out to be a much better movie director, like her father, than an actress. Good for her. There's a very young Joe Mantegna. George Hamilton appears in it. So again, lots of big names in this. It completes the story of Michael Corleone, a mafia kingpin who tries to legitimize his criminal empire. The film also weaves into its plot a fictionalized account of real-life events, which includes the 1978 death of John Paul I and the papal banking scandal of 1981 and 82, and links them with each other and with the affairs of Michael Corleone. Like I said, this movie had merit. I actually think if they had made it in 1976 and used it to complete this trilogy, I think it would have had better impact, better influence. I think too much time had passed. He's trying to become legitimate. He's trying to walk away from his past. He wants to set up his children in legitimate circumstances, in a legitimate business. And he just keeps getting dragged in and dragged in and dragged in. That's the crux of the movie. But they took 2 hours and 50 minutes to tell that. So the execution was poor, I would put it that way. Okay. And I also think, like I said, that too much time had passed, 16 years. And I think that generation of immigrant Italians who connected with the first two had grown up, had moved on. And I'll use myself as an example here. And I thought about this today. When I was that kid sitting on my grandmother's carpet, I identified as being an Italian Australian. If somebody asked me what nationality I was either Italian or an Italian Australian. The two are intertwined. It was like I was the you know, I was either and both. But over that 16 years, my identity changed. I no longer consider myself an Italian Australian. I consider myself an Australian with an Italian heritage. And I think it's possible that that generation of Italian Americans, Italian Australians, Italian Canadians moved on from what they connected with this, first two movies. That's my little theory, my little thinking as to in part why these movies weren't, the third movie wasn't as successful. Yes, it wasn't executed well. There was enough content in the movie for people like myself to make those connections, those nostalgia connections. But I think, like myself, we'd moved on from that point.
Well, it's a generational gap as well. I mean, right. at that point, it wasn't even just that people had moved on, but so much of the population that existed in those communities also was just kind of like, well, I've only ever been in Australia.
Right. So, yes, that's me, as well as in that 16 years, a lot of the original, those early immigrants have passed on, have died. You know, 16 years is a long time. A lot of people sort of, you know, past this mortal coil in that time. Now, I said that I don't remember a single thing about this movie until I rewatched it today. In the odd occasion that this part three comes up in conversation, it only ever reminds me of one personal story, an incident that happened to me that is strongly connected to the movie. But for some reason, I just do not remember the movie at all. So this is the story. I was 22, moved out of home, but living on my own for a year. I was in my first job as a nurse. It's a quiet day at work. I'm in the nurse's station. It's just myself and the ward clerk. I grab the paper and I'm flicking through it. I get up to the movie section of the paper, and there in big, you know, quarter page ad is the Godfather 3 movie being advertised. And I must have said out aloud, oh, yeah, that's right, Godfather 3's out. I need to go see this movie. Now, by this time, the ward clerk had moved over and was standing over my shoulder and sort of looking at the movie section with me. And she made comment along the lines of, you know, oh, that's right, that is out. It's a bit of a big deal, isn't it? And I said, oh, look, for me, it was huge, you know, sort of growing up in my family and all the Italian connection, yada, yada, yada. And she goes, oh, that, you know, it might be interesting to see. And I just, now, the reason why I'm telling this story is this story reminds me of how much of a social moron, a social imbecile I was for a good part of my early life. I can't remember if I ever mentioned it on this show, but I received very little social training growing up in the household that I grew up with, Sorry?
Your household of no toys.
Well, that too. And I will fully admit, I was a very sensitive child. I took things very personally. I was very shy, but I was never modeled how to interact and socialize with people other than my immediate family and my immediate Italian-Australian community. We had very little to do with Anglo-Saxons, with Irish, so forth. We occasionally came, we had my my grandmother's neighbors were Greek, so they made friends and would come over and we'd interact with them. But very little Anglo socialization as I grew up. And I'm an immature male. So she says to me, she's showing sort of positive suggestions towards this movie. And I said, we should go and see it. And she said, yeah, that'd be great. So we proceed the next minute or two to hash out a time and a place and yada, yada, yada. And she makes the comment, you know, I've been waiting for about a year to ask me out to see a movie. And that makes no sense to me. It makes no connection. I don't understand what she meant by that.
This is so awkward.
It is very awkward. So day comes, we make our own way to the movies. We meet out the front. We go in, watch the movie. I come out, like I said, I don't remember anything of the movie, but I remember my disappointment of coming out from that movie. And as we're standing out the front, I said, that was very disappointing. I was expecting so much more. The first two were so much better. And she pipes in and says, I've not seen the first two movies. Again, I don't make the connection. I don't see what's happening in front of me. And all I can think of is, why would you see part three of a movie series when you haven't seen one and two? And we proceed to stumble about the next hour or so. We go get a drink, we have a bite to eat. And I don't see what's happening in front of me. We make our own way home. It wasn't until about 3, maybe 4 days later, I went, holy shit. That's what was happening. She didn't give a shit about the movies. She was trying to connect with me. Now, like I said, I'm a bit of a social moron. I have very fixed ideas about how boy and girl relationships should happen. And I completely missed this. And I think back on my uni days, not that I had women, no way did I have like girls throwing themselves at me. But when I think back, there was probably two or three other occasions where certain females who were interested in me made steps towards me and I just didn't see it. I just did not get it, what was happening in front of me. I guess I had very set blinkers on how this thing should happen and I didn't see what was happening around me. And I just, not having the social practice, didn't pick up on any of the verbiage, the clues, the hints that were basically being pounded into my face. And I just didn't connect it. So that's what this movie, Godfather Part 3 for me represents. My social ineptitude growing up, because I remember nothing about the movie, but you can't bring up Godfather Part 3 without me remembering this incident with poor Amanda. Because, like I said, after about 3 or 4 days, I clicked what was happening. So I then tried to reconnect, tried to ask her out, tried to invite her out to a movie, and she wasn't having a bar of it. She went ice cold. She was obviously a woman scorned and just did not want anything more to do with me. So, yeah, that's what Godfather Part 3 means to me. Boy, okay. So.
Is it safe to come back?
It's safe to come back. It's fine. It's all good.
Okay.
I find it therapeutic. And it's part of the reason why I do it on this show, is to talk about difficult and awkward situations. Because I find it therapeutic. It's helped me move on, understand, progress in my maturity as a person, is to go back and objectively put aspects of my life in its place. And that's what this does. That's what this part of my reason why I'm here on this podcast is for therapy. So thank you guys.
I need to start charging you then.
I need a clipboard and a pencil. Just a moment.
There you go. I need to get a sofa then. So that's the movies for me. I'll wrap it up by saying these couple extra things here. Like I said, I've just rewatched these three movies and I really enjoyed the first two, both for enjoying the cinematic creations that were Godfather Part 1 and Godfather Part 2, and for the nostalgia aspect. Now, I'm not going to sit here and say definitively that these two movies, particularly the first two, created that whole genre, or that it created that whole, it shaped the whole crime family, mob, mafia, criminal family type of genre. But if it didn't, it strongly influenced everything that came afterwards. It created tropes that have been carried on in similar movies time and time again. The father, the head figure, be seen as very papal, very holy, very, he says something once and orders are carried out. The trope of the hothead elder son, the trope of the reluctant younger son who wants nothing to do with his family, with the business, but somehow gets pulled back in. It created great language, like make you an offer too good to refuse. Keep your friends close and your enemies closer. It's not personal, it's business. And those three lines, in some form or another, have been repeated again and again in mobster movies, in crime, organized crime type movies. So, like I said, I don't claim that they created these tropes, these standards, but I think it strongly influenced a lot of what came afterwards. And I've mentioned that the first one is certainly up in my top three or five movies of all time. I can't help but just have waves and waves of nostalgia watching these first two movies. It was just like I said, I felt like I was on my grandmother's carpet, sitting cross-legged watching that movie, hearing my grandmother commenting over my shoulder. And lastly, this movie did something for me that no other movie has ever done. And that's brought my Christian name into lexicon, into the general population. I can't tell you how many people who I have said my name is Vito and I get a queried look on their face because they're trying to place it, where it's from, where its origins are, whereabouts. What do I look like? Do I look Greek? Do I look Italian? Do I look Yugoslavian? I should say, well, Yugoslavia back then when these movies were being made. I had a neighbor, little old Anglo-Saxon lady who lived next door to us in one of the houses, who called me Peter. She called me Peter because she couldn't get her head around calling me Vito. And I sat down once and I wrote down, I think, 17 variations or alternatives that people have called me instead of calling me Vito. The Godfather, Don Corleone, is Vito Corleone. It's quite a common Southern Italian name, particularly in Sicily and Calabria, where my family are from. Funny enough, I come from a town, little township in Calabria called San Vito, Saint Vito. All the majority of firstborn sons were called Vito. I have, or as I was growing up, I had uncles called Vito. I had came across people from the village where my parents came from who are called Vito. But outside of that, never. And at school, so the primary school I went to, there were a couple other kids called Vito. But outside of that, never come across another Vito unless they were Southern Italian. So I used, as I was growing up, not as much as I was growing up, but as I started entering adulthood and getting out into the workforce, and I'm a registered nurse, so I have to introduce myself to my patients every single day, three or four, five, six, ten times a day. I have to introduce myself. I say, you know, I'm Vito, I'm your nurse for today. I don't do it as much now, but I certainly did it when it was earlier. And they go, Vito. And I go, yeah, Vito, like the Godfather. And a lot of them connected it to that. Oh, they go, ah, like the Don, Vito Corleone. So I have these movies to thank for allowing my name to be made a little bit more common than it really is. And particularly now, it's even less common because it was sort of expected that sons would name their firstborn son Vito, and now those generations have left Italy, have moved on, having children, and they're not naming their sons Vito anymore. So I'm probably a bit of a dying breed in name, first name, I guess. It's funny, though. My name is Vito. Four letters, V-I-T-O, and people prefer to call me Veet. Claire prefers to call me Veet. You guys call me Veet. I don't mind. I really don't. But I find it a little curious that people call me Veet.
It's one less syllable.
I guess so.
I'm not even kidding. I'm not even kidding.
I know. It's, yeah. I know it's nothing more than that. But
We have a person in our like raid team right now named Salitha, and we call her Sully because it's just quicker.
Yep, and that's human nature to sort of call people by the shortest name possible to identify them.
It's weird in my family. I have family that live in Georgia. And that entire side of the family in Georgia, my name is James. They call me Jimmy.
Yeah. Well, that's
I've never understood that. No one else in my family does it. Sort of everyone thing. From Georgia calls me Jimmy.
Jimmy.
Hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And that's weird to me because, like, as a Robert, it's really annoying because everyone's like, hey, Bob. Hey, Rob. Hey, Robbie. I'm just like, can you go get hit by a bus now, please?
I hate Bob. Yeah. I hate that.
Yeah.
And like I hate it. I can't stand it. I am so against it.
Even Rob, people calling you Rob.
Yeah, I don't like it. I'm like everybody. Like, how do you go? I'm like Robert.
Okay.
Yeah. Your brother calls you Robbie.
Yeah. Well, no, my immediate family gets away with it because they've done it my entire life. But if you're not part of my immediate family, you don't get to do that.
Yeah, I have to say though, I have no longer used that Godfather connection because I made it a couple of weeks ago and it fell flat. I said, they go Vito. It's a bit of a strange name. I go, yeah, like the Godfather, Vito Corleone. And there was just like blank stares in front of me. And I'm going, we've generationally moved on from those movies. So I guess totally. I won't be making that connection.
It doesn't have the same pull as Star Wars, clearly.
No, true.
Or true, Aliens. True.
That's maybe I should do that partition Disney to throw a veto in one of their movies, and then that way I can make a movie connection again. It's been the odd veto appear in a movie here and there, but obviously not as prominently as it does in this movie. So that's it. That's my very personal, nostalgic experience of these three movies. They are on Netflix. Certainly recommend the first two. Be be prepared to take breaks. You'll get a sore butt if you try and watch them from beginning to end. But they are very good movies, and quite significant in the whole movie, as part of the movie industry, the movie genres that these movies take place in. There you go.
Cool.
All right then.
Yeah.
So.
Yes.
This has been episode 204 of... No, wait. Yeah. You know?
Yeah. 204.
I should feel bad for that poor woman now. All I'm going to take away from this episode.
What? The poor Amanda that I ignored.
I'm just like, this poor person. No, I don't know. I have a strangely similar story that's much more on the nose, so I'll spare everybody.
Yeah. Anyway, James 204. Okay. Yeah. I know. And I've seen that sort of portrayed in sort of teenage movies and sort of things. So I'm not saying I'm unique in that way. It's just that Godfather 3 for me has no other meaning to me other than it reminds me of that story, of that incident, and that aspect of my social inability.
Don't you hate it when you like are able to attach something like personally significant to something that has nothing to do with it?
Yep.
Absolutely. I hate that because there's a bunch of things now where it's just like, oh, I really want to watch Game of Thrones, but that just makes me think of people. Shit.
Yeah.
You know, it was like, I've got problems like that. Yeah. So, yeah, I know exactly what you're going to. Pretty sure a lot of people do.
Yep.
So, what's the next episode about?
They can't stop the signal.
They can't ever. Stop.
Nope.
No?
Unless they kill me with a sword.
Okay.
Wait. Highlander?
Oh, God. all of you just lost your Firefly cards.
Oh, Firefly. Yeah, well, okay. I came to Firefly late, so I may have to. I came to it quite late, so I may have to sit down and
you're excused.
Watch it. Yeah. And it's Netflix.
And conveniently, it's short.
Yes.
Thanks for just
conveniently, everything canceled. Sadly. Conveniently, but very sadly, it's a short.
Yeah, yes. I actually have a different opinion about that, which I can get into in the next episode. But yeah, no, yeah, it's a short show. So if you need to get caught up, you totally can. I don't need to get caught up. It's engraved in my brain.
Cool.
I'll probably watch it again for the lulls, however, because that seems to be what I do on occasion.
All right. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/N1'sKin, no spaces, no apostrophe. You can also get new episodes with any of the apps on your smartphone. And you can watch us there.
You can watch that orange bar move.
On SoundCloud. All right. Bye, guys.
Buonasera.
Later.
I make you an offer you can't refuse.
I'll refuse it.
Look forward to Godfather 4 with a CG Marlon Brando.
That'd be awesome.